Come with us to the land of Genghis Khan and ride with us through the vast open spaces and into the rugged mountains. Once called Outer Mongolia, it's the most sparsely populated independent country in the world. Our trek took us into the mountains to the Darhat Valley, just south of the Russian border. 14 members of the Appalachian Mountain Club, ages ranging from the 50s to 81, and our Mongolian staff of guides, wranglers, cooks, and drivers, spent 2 weeks exploring an area just south of the Russian border. Our destination was the Darhat Valley, where nomads have lived for centuries during the warmer months, grazing their herds of horses, yaks, goats, and sheep. We climbed through mountain passes and crossed numerous gravel riverbeds fed by the melting mountain snows. Our two Appalachian Mountain Club leaders were Sue and Dick, who arranged this trip through Boojum, a small Montana-based organization which offers, quote, uncommon adventures, unquote. They also collaborate with a nonprofit group working with the nomadic population in Mongolia, helping develop their social services and infrastructure. These are our two Mongolian guides, who you'll meet later. We headed for Lake Kosgol, the third largest lake in Asia, fed from Asia's largest lake, Baikal, in Siberia just to the north. There we took an old Russian cargo ship halfway up the lake, where we started our climb through the mountains to the valley. We finally joined up with our horses after the long boat ride. As you can see, Mongolian horses are small in size, but they're very sturdy. Dick seems way too big for his horse, but it carried him with no problem. Horses are Mongolia's most valuable animal. They're even pictured on their paper money, and they roam freely in herds when not working. In this natural terrain, their hooves do not need shoeing. Their manes are clipped except for one section kept long, making it easy to grab when rounding them up. The horses we rode belong to our wranglers, who live in this nomad valley during the warmer months. When we've made stops along the way, they like to hang out with buddies from their own specific herd. As working animals, they did not have names, but of course we each had to give a name to the horse we rode. Small flies sometimes pestered our horses, and my horse liked to mosey up to one of his buddies as we rode along, and he put his nose in its tail, a good way to brush off the flies. He was able to do this even when we were trotting, so I named him Taylor. Some of the wranglers had fancy leather saddles, but ours were more primitive affairs, a plastic-covered felt pad tied over a wood and metal frame with a rope. We were concerned about getting saddle sore, but surprise, we did not, even though we had a couple of 6-hour, 18-mile days. Betty finally gave this little girl the bicycle helmet she'd brought along for protection, as it really wasn't needed. Note Betty's leather chaps. These were indispensable when gripping the horse's sides with our calves when we trotted, standing in the stirrups and riding up off the saddle, Mongolian style. We camped most nights on the trek, and we blew up our Big Agnes sleeping mats each night. It took about 150 breaths. We use these rather than the bulkier thermarest we are accustomed to, as they are smaller and lighter to pack, and they proved to be very comfortable. Our potty was a trench dug in the tundra, with a tarp around three sides to provide privacy. Running water, even, in a water jug hung on a tripod. Some mornings we found it had even been heated, and do notice the soap. We were amazed to find ourselves stepping on the edelweiss covering the ground. It's not found only in the Alps. Temperatures during the days were mostly in the 50s and 60s, although a couple of cooler days found us bundled up in almost every layer we had with us. Some nights were below freezing, and we'd awake to find we needed to knock off shards of ice when we unzipped our tent flies. Middle-of-the-night exits to pee were a most trying undertaking. We had not brought warm gloves. Here Betty has added warmth by covering her gloves with plastic bags in which our local newspaper is delivered. We had these with us, as their narrow size makes them good to use as shoe bags in our luggage. They worked really well as mittens. Note the wood and leather thong crop in Betty's hand. More on that later. The nomads live in portable houses called gurs, so that they can move their animals to new grazing areas during the summer. We know them as yurts, but this is a Russian term disliked by Mongolians. Some have a solar panel for energy, and usually there is a bowl of cheese curds drying on the roof. This gur belonged to our head wrangler, who had a few additional modern conveniences. Interiors have a central wood stove and are colorfully decorated. The folding lower framework is reminiscent of those kitty gates we used long ago, and is connected to a circular frame and covered with felt, warm in winter and cool in summer. The circular shape resists the wind. All furniture and storage is arranged around the outer walls and made up of modular components for easy disassembly. Even with all the furnishings, these gurs can be set up and dismantled in no more than an hour. Check out the pile of unassembled parts. All these parts and furnishings are traditionally carried on the backs of yaks. It must be something to watch them packing up. We stayed in two towns during the trek, in lodging facilities run by Bujum. These guest gurs serve the few tourists who visit this area. I thought we should call them gurtels. These gurs offered comfortable beds and warm stoves, and someone came each night to light the stove with the wood that was provided. A lodge provided indoor dining, as well as toilets. One even had flush toilets with explicit directions for use. These directions indicate the world must be well represented by the few visitors who do come. The effort to be environmentally conscious was evident in our first lodge, where we got explicit instructions on how to use the two-holed desiccating toilet system. Take a few seconds to read down through the list. The remoteness and beauty of the landscape were amazing, but so was our wonderful Mongolian staff. Our head guide was Biamba, who spoke excellent English and was always looking after us. His loud call of, "Well, shall we?" became a familiar note when it was time to start moving. You'll hear him later in this show. Segi, our assistant guide, was from the capital city of Ulaanbaatar, and surprisingly, this was her first horse trek. Eric was a guide in training, and here you see him demonstrating how to tie the sash on a dal, the traditional Mongolian outer garment. The sash is multi-purpose, providing support on long rides, a bit like a corset. You'll see both men and women have much fancier versions of this garment as well. Nimfu was our head wrangler. At one of our campsites, he made these crops for each of us, using willow branches and rawhide. They were especially welcome to those whose horses needed prodding, and calls of shoo, shoo, the Mongolian version of giddy-up, were not quite enough. Wrestling has long been one of Mongolia's national sports, and Nimfu was a champion wrestler. The bare chest on the garment stems from the day when a woman masquerading as a man won a tournament. This design assures that that can't happen again. We watched him win the grand prize in the Nadam Festival held in town at the end of our trek. That's him disrobing, getting ready to enter the contest. Mishig is a local official, long active in the government of the region, and also on the staff of Bioregions, the nonprofit that Bujum works with. He provided and drove the truck, which carried our gear, and also provided kitchen space on the first part of our trek. The truck was not in view as we rode along, but it was a welcome sight awaiting us at lunchtime and at the end of the day. Maggie and her assistant Tamaro cooked us sumptuous meals from scratch. Numerous dishes were prepared for each meal, using only a two-burner propane stove set up in the truck. The quality of the food was our biggest surprise. Various meats, along with lots of fresh transportable vegetables, soups, pilafs, coleslaws, mashed potatoes, both white and sweet, and even freshly fried potato chips, all definitely aimed at the American palate and expertly seasoned. Fresh yak cream, much like English clotted cream, spread on fried bread made a breakfast I'll always remember. On the second part of the trek, we changed trucks, and the back of this old Russian army truck became the kitchen. This old truck had periodic breakdowns, giving us ample opportunity to hang out and experience what we learned to call Mongolian time. There was lots of posing for photos during this downtime. After posing for this photo, Tamaro gave me a memento, a lovely handmade pouch containing the four sheep ankle bones used in the traditional Mongolian bone game, often offered as a token of friendship. There are many versions of games played with these bones, and they are also used in fortune telling. The two convex sides, horse and sheep, are considered lucky, and if used for points in a game, the horse is worth the most. Food and drink are used worldwide to welcome strangers. We watched this woman trudge toward us across the open valley, grandson and bucket in hand to greet us. In the bucket was freshly made yak yogurt, offered to us as a welcome, just delicious. Shamanism is the primary religion in this area, and we saw numerous shrines called odos. The pyramid of cloth-draped poles is covered with relics and mementos, such as the skulls of favorite horses. The ritual is to walk around it three times in a clockwise direction, to call on the spirits that watch over you in the past, present, and future. Russians eliminated most Buddhist monks and temples during their domination, but in the valley town, we saw new evidence of a resurgence. Now, follow along as we embark on our wonderful adventure. Here is our wonderful wrangler, Sodu. You'll learn more about him later.
Can you see the little ponies shine before your eyes? All the pretty little ponies gonna be there.